Welcome to First United Methodist Church in Starkville, Mississippi. We're proud that you're joining us in worship today. People have gathered throughout the community in the church building itself, and now we invite you to come and be a part of us in your living room or wherever you may be as we worship together today.
Welcome to the morning service of First United Methodist Church of Starkville, the church in the heart of the town with Christ in the heart of the church. Our weekly Sunday services are at 8:30 and 11 a.m., and our evening service is at 6 p.m. Join us now as we come together and exalt Jesus Christ our Lord.
Proceeds go to benefit our youth program here at the church, so please sign up for this special day. Next Sunday is communion, and we will be taking up an offering for Camp Lake Stevens to make sure that all the children in our church who want to go to Camp Lake Stevens are able to go. So please be sure to bring that donation with you next Sunday. Also next Sunday, we will break ground on our Habitat House, and so that is an exciting day as well. And I want you to read the front of your bulletin for more details about that. So we're very proud that we break ground next week. Also want you to remember in prayer this week the families of Mr. Morris Thompson of our church who died this week, and also the family of Jessica Burke. She directed the Society of St. Andrews and worked with our church with several special projects, and so we are saddened by her by the loss of her and also the others in the wreck, so we want to be sure to hold all of them in our prayers this week. Would you please stand and join with me in the call to worship? Propelled by the desire of our hearts, we seek your face, God.
God is our light and our salvation.
Teach us your way, God, and be gracious to us.
We seek the goodness of God, and our hearts fill with courage.
O God of light and salvation, we seek your face this morning. Fill us with your life-giving spirit as we worship, so that we might go out into the world and fill it with your life-giving love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our opening hymn of praise is number 545, The Church's One Foundation.
Oh,
to page 881 and let us recite together this historic confession of our faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. In prayer. O God of all creation, you call us out of our ordinary lives to come and be in your presence. When you look at us, you love us just the way we are, and you encourage us to be all you created us to be. You call us into a different way of living, a way that values peace, integrity, and faithfulness, in a world torn apart by conflict and corruption and self-serving acts. Your commandment to follow me leads us into the diversity of your world, and it's not always easy to love or accept people who are different than we are, but you journey with us as we try to follow you. So here in the company of our neighbor that we know and the strangers in our midst, we ask you to help us love as you love. Forgive us when we neglect those around us. Help us see what is special about each person we come in contact with, even those we are most familiar with. Forgive us when we do not follow you and instead follow a path of sin. We are grateful for your grace and forgiveness, and we vow to try again to be your disciples as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us so long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now it's time for our children to come join Miss Jane at the altar.
You know, telephones are wonderful things, aren't they? You all probably have phones. Everybody has a phone at their house, and a lot of people have them in their purses and in their pockets. And cell phones are especially great, aren't they? Because we can call. Like that? Well, we can call friends and family, stay in touch with them. We can make appointments. If you're on the soccer field late and you don't feel like cooking supper, you can just call from the soccer field and order a pizza. All kind of great things for the cell phone. Some phones even do things like you can text message or you can send or receive emails. Some phones, I won't do it right now, but I could take a picture of you right now with my telephone and then send it to someone. But they're great, aren't they? One feature of cell phones, or all phones, is voicemail, where you can call and leave a message and tell someone something you want to tell them or ask them to call you back. Some people are pretty good about listening to their messages and returning calls, but some people don't ever listen to their message and don't return the calls very much, do they? But I want to tell you about a message that a friend, we all have a friend who has left us a message and invited us all to go fishing with him. Now, I thought it might be Mr. Danny because he's a good fisherman, but I don't think he would want us all in his boat. We might scare the fish off. But, so it's not Danny, so there's one, but we do have a friend who's invited us to go fishing with him, but it's a different kind of fishing trip, and it's Jesus. And Jesus is inviting us to go fishing with him, but it's not to go fishing for fish, it's to go fishing for people. And the message wasn't left on a voicemail machine, the message is in the Bible. And this is how we know. One day Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee, and he saw two fishermen, Simon Peter and Andrew, and they were throwing their nets out into the water catching fish. Jesus came up to them and said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Do you know what they did? Immediately they dropped their nets and went with Jesus. So they were walking on a little bit farther, and they saw two more brothers, James and John. They were fishermen also. They were sitting in their boats mending their nets. And they invited James and John to come along with them too. They dropped their nets and went right with them too. Now, even though this story is about Jesus calling his first disciples, there's also a message in it for us. And that message is that Jesus wants us all to follow him and to be fishers of people. That means to help make disciples. And the best way I know to explain that would be for us to help people learn how to follow Jesus, to help people, to tell people about Jesus so that they will follow him. Now, will you hear that message that Jesus is giving to you today? And will you return that call? Will you pray with me? Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the way you call us. Please help us be like Peter and Andrew, James and John, and hear your call and answer you. Amen. Right, if you're 4 or 5,
there is an error in your order of worship. Our offertory hymn is number 562, "Jesus, Lord, We Look to Thee." Please stand.
God, we do give you our lives, our hearts, our minds, our everything, in hopes that you would make us one. We also give our tithes and our offerings this morning in hopes that you would make this world one. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Our scripture today comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 4, verses 12 through 23. Matthew 4, chapter 3, verses 12 through 23. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who have sat in darkness have seen a great light, and for those who sat in the region in the shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, choir, and thank you, Michael Brown, for beautiful music setting the tone for our worship this morning. We thank you so much for that. The dream catcher is a tradition among Native Americans, I understand. And scholars say that the tradition originated with the Ojibwa nation. Their word for dream catcher actually means spider. And traditionally, the Ojibwa constructed a dream catcher by tying strands of sinew into a web, like they did their snowshoes, and then attaching that web to a round frame that was usually made of willow branches. And feathers were usually attached to the frame as well. And the feathers represented breath or air, and therefore life. The dreamcatcher was hung over the bed of the sleeping child to protect the child from bad dreams. Now, legend has it that a dreamcatcher filters a person's dreams. It allows the good dreams to filter through, but it catches the bad dreams and holds those bad dreams until the light of day when they disappear. According to that tradition, with a dreamcatcher, all the dreams are good dreams. All the dreams are good dreams. Well, I certainly needed a dream catcher a while back. This week I celebrated the fact that it's been 1 year since I had my neck surgery. And during that time, before the surgery in particular, I was taking some pretty powerful medicines. Now, let me share with you as well that sometimes even an aspirin causes me to do silly things. And I was taking the hard stuff for pain. And I know it was the medicine that made me have that dream. I know that. I dreamed that I was out in the country and that every person who is part of this church was chasing me. Little, big, old, young, every one of you were chasing me. Now, why you were chasing me, I don't know. Sometimes dreams don't let you in on all the little details. So I don't know why you were chasing me. I just know that I was running as fast as I could run, and you were chasing me, and you were angry with me, screaming insults, shaking your fist, and even waving sticks that you held in your hand, things like that. I was running just as fast as I could, and you were gaining on me. I saw some of your faces in my dream, but I'm not going to name names this morning. Now, the good thing, in fact, the best thing about that dream was that I woke up, and I felt myself, I realized that I was me and that I was in my bed, not out in the country with a bunch of angry church folks chasing after me. So I felt better about the whole situation. Now, I'm not superstitious. I'm not superstitious. But I have heard it said that if you tell a dream before breakfast, it will come true. And that's the reason I've waited a whole year before I told you that one. I could have used a dream catcher for sure that day, but the truth is, most of us need to catch a dream. Most of us need to catch a dream, something that will change our lives dramatically. Something that will change our lives dramatically. Something that will change the way we live now and change us into something even better than we are. Some dreams are revealing, they say, and sometimes useful. In fact, I read about one man who went to the psychiatrist, and right away the psychiatrist asked him, "Did you have a dream last night?" And it kind of caught the man off guard, and he thought about it and said, No, come to think about it, I didn't have a dream last night. And the psychiatrist said, "Well, how in the world do you expect me to help you if you don't do your homework?" Not all dreams are good, even some that are very well-meaning. Some years ago, a man, and let's just call him George, called the church that I was serving at the time to make an appointment to talk to me. Now, he was a nice man, a businessman, and a member of my church. But he made an appointment to come and talk to me, so I knew it was serious business. I knew that. And when he came to my office, he asked me probably the dumbest question that I have ever been asked in my whole life. He said, "Can the church use some money?" Now, what kind of question is that? What kind of question is that? A church can always use some money, and keep that in mind. But the church can always use money. And I said, "Well, yeah, the church can use some money." Then he said, "I can tell you how the church can make lots of money." And I was thinking, tell me more. But then he said, "All you have to do is convince at least 15 people in the congregation to invest in this investment club that is going around town." And he said, "The more people and the more money, the more the church stands to make." And then he said, "We're all going to get rich. Before you know it, the church will have all the money it will ever need." And then he named names of people that I knew and told how much money that they had already made in this investment club. Boy, did this fella have a dream. Did he have a dream? At first, it sounded good, really good. But the more he talked, the more I became afraid of it. And when I told him that I didn't think the church would get involved in that, he couldn't believe it. In fact, you'd have thought that I just stepped on his mother's grave. He said, "Do you mean to tell me that you're going to turn down all the money for the church? Just think of all the church could do with all that money." I didn't buy into his dream. And a few weeks later, I learned that the pyramid failed. The pyramid fell. It came crashing down. And as it is with all pyramid schemes, those who got in early made a little money. It's the latecomers who always end up holding the bag and losing the money. It was a dream. Just not a good dream. Just not a good dream. Not a very realistic dream. And George was trying his very best to sell it to me. There are lots of dreams out there. You know that. There are lots of dreams out there. There's always someone wanting to sell you a dream. So, we must be careful when it comes to catching dreams. We must be careful when it comes to catching dreams. In fact, my friends, in our scripture for today, Jesus himself was trying to sell a dream to four fishermen. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever thought about it? Maybe you've never looked at it in this way at all, but that is what Jesus was doing in our scriptures today, trying to sell his dream, trying to sell a new way of life, a new way of doing things. Jesus' dream, though, it was different. It was different, all right. In fact, Jesus' dream turned the worldly thinking upside down, completely upside down. Jesus' dream looked at our way of life in a whole different way, in a new way. Jesus' dream was radical for sure. It was a radical dream, radical to say the least. Today, we have the advantage of hindsight, and we know that the dream of Jesus was a good dream. We know that. But we have to be careful, because when you're listening to a dreamer, you better know that it's a good dream. You better know that it's a good one before you buy into it. But how? How do you know? And how, my friends, did those four fishermen know that it was a good dream? How did they know that? They were probably uneducated, common folks. It seems to me that there must have been more that took place than what Matthew has written down on paper. Now, John the Baptist had just been arrested, and he would be killed later because he upset the powers that be. You do remember that, don't you? You do remember that John was the one preaching repentance down by the Jordan River, even baptized Jesus. baptized Jesus, but now he has been arrested. And when Jesus learned of this, he left his home in Nazareth and moved over to Capernaum, which is on the northeastern shore of the Sea of Galilee. And lo and behold, Jesus took some of John's sermon notes and began preaching them. But it was just one page. It was just one page. That's all, for that's all that John needed. John's sermon was the same. Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. That's what John was preaching. That's what John was preaching. And it was stuff like that that got old John in the predicament that he was now in. And then one day, while Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon Peter and Andrew. They were fishermen, and they were doing like fishermen do. They were casting their nets. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And Matthew wrote, "Immediately they left their nets and followed him." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. Remember that word, immediately. Remember that word. And then Jesus saw two other brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. They too were fishermen, and they were in the boat with their father mending their nets, menial chores. But that's what you must do if you want to catch fish over and over again. Mend your nets. And again, Matthew used that word, immediately. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. No discussion. No maybes. No, well, let me think about it a while. I'll meet you back about this time next week. No, first let me go and do thus and so. None of that. Matthew said, immediately. Jesus said, "Follow me," and immediately they followed him. Now, if we take these verses of Matthew at face value, and why shouldn't we? Why shouldn't we? We just might be witnessing the biggest miracle in all the Bible, right here in these verses. Because Jesus said to these professional fishermen, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And then Matthew writes, and immediately they left their boats, they left their businesses, they left their families, they left their livelihood, they left their secure way of life, and followed him. Wow. Now let me be honest with you. It is okay to be honest in the church, is it not? Had I been one of those four fishermen, the way Matthew has it written here, it would have been easier for me to buy into George's pyramid scheme than to follow this stranger who was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, inviting folks to come and go with him and fish in a new way. Surely something else was said. Or surely something else was done. Something more. But we don't know. We don't know, do we? When I was struggling with this message, I pulled a volume of John Wesley's Notes on the New Testament off the shelf. I wanted to read what John Wesley said about the calling of these four fishermen, and I was convinced that surely Wesley would have written something about prevenient grace here. I just knew that Wesley would have written that this was an excellent example of God's Spirit going before the event and God preparing the heart of these big burly fishermen so that they would know, that they would definitely know to follow Jesus' dream when he extended it to them. I just knew that. But when I looked it up, I discovered that Wesley did not write one word. Not one word. And frankly, I'm a little disappointed in Wesley here. I really am. He could have helped the preparation of the sermon a great deal, but he didn't. And I've had to struggle with my own thoughts And I've had to wonder, why? Why did those guys follow Jesus? What was it that caused these men to drop everything and follow Jesus Christ? What caused them to buy into his dream and to make it a way of life, his dream, I mean? What was it, something in his voice? Well, was that it? Was it something in his voice, or maybe something in the way he walked along the Sea of Galilee? Was there something special about his mannerism? Was it all of the above or none of the above? We can make it multiple choice. We don't know. We just don't know. I can't help but wonder. But you can say one thing for sure. These four fishermen caught the dream of Jesus. They caught Jesus' dream because they left everything. Everything. And they followed Jesus everywhere he went. And they tried to pattern their lives after Jesus. And that wasn't easy. That was not easy. Don't you think for one minute that it was easy for these four fishermen to follow Jesus and be his disciples? Because these fishermen, you see, were just like us. They were just like us. They were not perfect either. They weren't perfect either. And because it is a whole lot easier to look for the Messiah than it is to follow a Messiah after he appears. You did know that too, didn't you? That it's a lot easier for us to look for a Messiah than it is for us to follow a Messiah. That's why it's so tempting for ministers to say to you, and it's so tempting for the church to say to you, Jesus is coming now, get ready. Get ready, he's coming. So everybody get ready, prepare yourself. Jesus is coming. Sounds a lot like a hide-and-seek game we played as children. Ready or not, Jesus is coming. In this way, I suppose we all try to put ourselves in God's seat. We all try to put ourselves in God's seat because then it's so easy for us to insert our own dreams. It's so easy for us to control our own destiny. It's so easy for us to do what we want to do. Boy, when the Messiah comes, it's going to be like this or it's going to be like that. I just can't wait. Come on, Lord Jesus, come on. And in doing this, without knowing it, in doing this, we shape the Messiah. We shape the Messiah. We shape the Messiah that the world sees, that the world understands. Therefore, we shape God to fit our very own dreams, our very own desires, to shape God, to do what we would want God to do. Or at least we try. We try, don't we? It's a whole lot harder for those who represent the church to say very openly and honestly and frankly to you, Jesus is already here, so we must catch his dream and lay our own dreams aside, which is much, much, much harder. And Jesus' message to the world upon his arrival here was that it will no longer be business as usual. Things, if you follow me, if you're my disciple, then things will be different. It will not be business as usual. Don't you remember how Jesus gave us glimpses of his dreams as he walked here on earth? Yes, Jesus preached repentance. He did, with the idea that I have come to bring to the world a new way of thinking. And if you want to catch my dream, then you must change your ways to my ways and follow me. If you want to fish for people, then let me show you how. Let me show you how. Jesus began his ministry by saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And for him, the kingdom of heaven means that all people are equal, and that all people must live in unity, and that all people should share all the world's resources. Now, while I beg to differ with some of his theology, I think that the late John Lennon the former Beatle, caught a glimpse of Jesus' dream when he wrote the song, Imagine. Are you familiar with that song? Just listen to some of the words. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. Imagine no possessions. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger, a brotherhood or sisterhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. And then Lennon added these words, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you will join us and the world will live as one. My friends, Jesus said, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. And if you catch my dream, you will be like a city set high upon a hill. You cannot hide and you cannot be hidden. Everyone will see you. You'll be a witness to the world. Yes, my friends, God always offers us a larger, a bigger, a greater, a grander dream than we're willing to dream for ourselves. It's always bigger. It's always a greater challenge. Well, Jesus is already here. Jesus is already here. Now, what in heaven's name are you going to do about that? Some things in the Bible just don't make sense, at least to me. And this is one of them. Four professional fishermen left everything to follow a man with a dream. To follow a man with a dream, to fish for people when they were already catching fish, but to fish for people. To follow Jesus, to catch his dream, means to be willing to risk, my friends, to walk out of our cocoon, to walk out of our sanctuary, to walk out of our safety. It means to understand that it's not business as usual anymore. Our scripture for today says that one day Jesus walked along the shore of the Sea of Galilee and said to four professional fishermen, come on, follow me. I'll teach you to do what you're already doing in a mighty way. I'll teach you how to fish for people. And for some reason, they did. They did. They followed Jesus' dream. They caught the dream. They caught the dream. For whatever reason, they caught the dream. These four fishermen in our scripture discerned that to follow Jesus was God's will for their lives. So they dedicated themselves to Jesus, and they dedicated themselves to Jesus' way of life, and they followed him. They caught the dream. They caught the dream. Will you? Our hymn of invitation this morning is number 206. I want to walk as a child of the light. And that's what it means to catch the dream of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, to walk in his light, to let him guide you, to follow after him, to pattern your life after him, to be the person that God calls you to be. As we sing this hymn of invitation this morning, I invite you, if you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, we encourage you to do that today. If you're here and you'd like to be a part of the ministry that we share together here at First United Methodist Church, Starkville, we encourage you to do that. But most especially, catch the dream as we stand and sing together.
Thank you.
worship together. We know the light of Christ is here. Go and catch the dream. Go and share the dream. In the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior.